Hi. You know, I was going to take a minute and send this on Periscope, but what happened is that my network seemed to be moving slow, so it wouldn't pick it up. But I was moved in my spirit to send this message, and I pray that you afford it out, because we have a lot of people who are really dealing with a lot of dependent bondage. And what I mean by that, the Holy Spirit was showing me that there's a lot of soul ties of false responsibility. And so I thought that it was important that I send this message out as I began to pray and reflect on many things. Just wanted to make sure that I try to pull your coat and understand why you're going through that. And why do you do this, Dr. Murphy? Well, I do this because I understand how some leadership and how some people can be very prideful and refuse to go get any counsel. And I also do it because it's my responsibility that much is given, much is required of me to make sure that I flow in the gift that he has called me to do, and that is counseling and leadership and family. And so I think it's important that we build strong leadership so we can build strong churches and strong family. And so I wanted to share primarily, let me set my timer because I didn't want this to be over 15 minutes. Wanted to share also, based on this topic, I wanted to start out by talking about vows. You know, many of us have soul ties with oaths and vows that we have said and spoken to other people, you know, about what we're going to do. You know, Scripture clearly tells us that when we make a vow, it's better that you should have never made that vow. So I'm going to read Numbers 30, verse 7, part of it that says, "Then her vows shall stand, and her bonds wherewith she bound her soul shall stand." And see, what in this Scripture, what it's trying to say is that this hitch or this yoke that comes with a vow, what it does, it causes us to be fastened to what we have spoken. It causes us to be binded to, or to be responsible for holding or keeping what we have spoken. And so it's a good thing that we can do that, but at the same time, it's better that you didn't say it, you didn't mean it, because it's almost like you're speaking something in the heavenlies that God is not pleased about. According to Ecclesiastes 5, 5 and 6, it says, "Better is it that thou shouldest not vow than thou shouldest vow and not pay. Suffer not thy mouth to cause thy flesh to sin." We've got to watch how we are looking at certain issues or individuals, trying to put them on pedestals, or, you know, thinking that they so, you know, so anointed and this and that, that we cannot just say yay and nay. You know, we must not break our vows, but we must break soul tie vows that you knew that you should not have been involved with, you knew that you shouldn't have not done, but yet you did it for whatever vainglory or motive that you had in your heart. And you knew you couldn't keep this vow or this promise. But this vow issue has been very, very misunderstood. And even though it's been misunderstood, it's extremely important, especially for believers. See, because a vow is extremely, you know, vows, and as we begin to say that we are promising stuff, are very, very extremely serious. Because, you know, first of all, heaven, as a modern man, he is looking at us because we make vows and covenant with our Lord Jesus Christ. And so he said to Moses, he said, and that is Moses spoke and said in Numbers 31 and 2, he said, and Moses spoke saying, "This is a thing which the Lord hath commanded. If a man vow a vow unto the Lord, or swear an oath to bind his soul with a bond, he shall not break his word. He shall do according to all that proceeded out of his mouth." And so the significance of this passage cannot be ignored. Why? Because it smears an oath. It swears an oath. It makes a vow. That means his soul is bond to the situation. His soul is bond to what he has said. And so the basic key for us as believers, you know, we should always keep our mind on the fact that God binds himself to his word. He said in Psalms 89:34, "My covenant will I not break nor alter the thing that is gone out of my lips." And so man likewise need to bind himself to his word. We cannot just think that we can say that we're going to do something and we don't do it. God watches over that. Many times it's motive driven and it's manipulation, and it is very dependently driven, meaning that you have a reason why you wanted to do that, because you were dependent on a thing, or you're looking for a thing to be done in the motives of your heart or the plans that you were trying to get out of a thing. And so I don't want to go on and on with this, but I thought it was important that I did get you to think on that. But I have a couple of questions I want to ask, because one of the things that we don't realize is that we begin to set destruction for our own selves when we continue to do things or say things, you know, that are that not conducive to what we said, or are we doing something that is different to what we said we're going to do? And so it says this in Proverbs 18:7, a fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are the snare of his own soul. And so I want to share just a little bit about how important it is that we look at this part that causes us to be in this dependence bondage. What I mean by dependence bondage is simply this. Many times we find ourselves making these agreements with people because we feel obligated to them. And so now we've got our souls tied up with them as a relationship, whatever that is. But because of this obligation, it becomes a bondage. It becomes so intense to the point that the person don't know what to do, don't know what to say. All they know is that they knew that they had to get something from that person, or they need to be able to do a certain thing, you know, because they want to make sure they get something done for whatever reason. And actually, they're in this dependence bondage because they made this agreement or they made this obligation, you know, for whatever it was. But actually, sometimes this thing is introduced in a sense of falseness. You know, you knew that you didn't mean to do this, but now you want to be obligated to something that you really don't want to be obligated to. So you run from the thing rather than dealing with the thing, dealing with the matter. And so you are in this bondage of obligation is really what it is. You're in this obligation bondage because you made an agreement that you introduced something or said that you would be responsible for something, and that you said that you know, you would never do or you would want to always do, you know. So now you're in this obligation for what you have spoken. Same thing as a vow. And so this sense of false responsibility, what happens is sometimes it causes us to look at what are we doing to cause us to have these strings attached to what we have spoken. You know, when you hear these statements like, you know, you better do this with me now. Remember, I don't want to be, I may not be here long. You know, a lot of old people that, you know, that have kids that are at home. I don't want to say old, just let's say seniors, excuse me. Seniors that are at home, or parents that have come in their, you know, in their season, and they don't want the kid to leave. They'll always say, you don't remember. If you don't remember, you know, you promised me, I don't want you to be feeling bad, because, you know, when I go home in glory, you know, because I'm not going to be here much longer. So you find that kind of voice spoken out because they want you to stick to something you know you don't really want to do. You take it on this spouse responsibility. And then the other kind of voice that may come to you is words like, you know me, brother. You know me, sister. You know, I would do anything for you. You know, I would do that for you, you know, because, you know, I love you. You know, I'm sticking to you to the bone. You know, you my ride or die. You know, that kind of thing. When you start hearing these types of words, you know, and stuff like, if you don't do this for me, I don't know if my heart can stand it if you do anything different. I just don't know if I can take it. But see, what's happening is many of us are hearing these type of false responsibilities and false agreements or obligations based on friendships or based on ministry ties or whatever. And actually, it's all false. It's all deceptive. It's all, you know, an agreement of obligation that's caused many leaders and many parents to be in a dependence bondage, and cause those individuals who are connected to them to be in this spouse bondage as well, because many of the people who are bringing on this dependence bondage to themselves, many of them have these soul ties of false responsibilities. Now, when I say soul tie, I'm talking about those soul ties that are connected to you. You know, because those people that are close to you, those people you look up to. So you have a soul tie, which is a righteous soul tie, but it's a false responsibility, which means this is a form of dependence bondage. And so that means you're basing something you know that you would not do, you know you can't do, you know you don't want to do, you know you only want to do a certain thing for whatever motive, and so now everything was based on a lie. Why? Because you have made a decision that you are only going to get people to draw or be connected to you in this responsibility based on what your motive was about a thing. And that's really sad. And so God watches over this, because we constantly say these little words like, only you can save me. Oh, Lord, only you can help me. Can't nobody do it like you, Dr. Murphy. Can't nobody talk to me like that but you, Dr. Murphy. You know, oh, I can't never, ever. Oh, I'm sticking to you like glue. I'm always around you. And so these types of false responsibility, of false agreements and obligations have messed a whole lot of people up, because God is watching, because he knows that the motive of the heart was not good. And he says things, you know, people say stuff like, you're the only person who can help me with my problem. You're the only person who I know that can bring me out. You're the only person I know God has put in my life to help me get out of this. When in actuality, what it is that you're the only person that I'm going to tell this lie to, because I want to puff you up and make you think I need you. Many of these type are sap suckers. I'm going to keep that real. They're sap suckers because they have ulterior motives, or they don't know how to be real, because they've been fake so long. But I'm going to tell you right now, you have to look at what is the false responsibility that I put myself in a dependence bondage about. Because God is saying, I didn't do that, you did that. You look at the situation from day to day and make a decision. No one else can say this or open our mouths to make a commitment about a thing but us. And so these lies, you can say them all you want. They may feed the person's ego. They may even make them feel like they're super spiritual. But God knows these things are not true. God knows what the motive of the heart is. And that is why many people are walking around with self-inflicted dependence bondage. I know I'm talking to somebody. And so it's very important. That's why I took the time today to speak with you, resting here, getting ready to do some things, you know. And so it's important that we look at this and look at how we allow ourselves to do these things and think that God can't see them. Because what happens is the effect of this thing is we self-reject ourselves. And the result is even more dependence upon one favoring the other based on what is supposed to be getting to happen in that person's life. And most of the time, that person who has made this false obligation, the person who sees the deception, they just sit back and look at them and go, wow, why in the world do they want to hook themselves and chain themselves with these type of cords of bondage for whatever reason, for whatever motive? It's just unstable. It's not right. It's a fearful state to be in. Who wants to be in a vow that God is not pleased with? Who wants to be in a bondage or a lie for whatever reason? I think a lot of this stuff is that people just tend not to, you know, realize that man is frail. You cannot depend on the hand of man. You better be hearing God. And when you are not hearing God, you need to be quiet. That's what's wrong with people today. They talk too much, and they're thinking that they're hearing God. And that's why probably today you had a horrible day, or you've probably been having a horrible month, if we keep it real. You know, you've been having a horrible month because you don't know what to do about a matter. You don't know how to handle a matter because your mind is confused because it's so tangled up with dependence bondage. You know, many people have made responsibilities for themselves that God has not put upon them. Had they taken these false responsibilities that God is saying to you, why? Why you want to play that game? Why? Why would you do that? Why would you say that? Why would you go over there and do that? Why would you want to act like all these people are little gods in your life, and I'm going to be the only God in your life? Why would you say that when you know that that didn't even come from me? You know I didn't tell you to do that. God is not telling you that this person needs to be in your life. Oh, I believe I need to do this or that. You just wanted to do that because it's easier for you. You better hear me. This is counsel to you, whoever's listening on the sound of my voice. God knows the motives. He knows the very thought and intent of our hearts. And so I got to say this to you so you can understand whoever's listening to this. The reason why your day may not have been good today, the reason why you have not had good days or months and sometimes not even good sleep, it's because you're in dependence bondage. Many of you that is listening is in this dependence bondage is because you're consumed with trying to please everybody else, and God is not telling you to do these things. So now you're stuck on trying to please and be a certain person in certain environments that God ain't told you to go, God ain't told you to do. You just want to do to try to look super spiritual or try to look like that you're on the road of something. But you ain't nowhere but just in bondage. Lord, help us all today. And so my question to you today before I hang up from here, and you take this to the bank, God is talking to you. Was your day, if you be honest, a good day today? Knowing that you are in bondage, knowing that you have been lying, knowing that you have been pretending. Was your day good? How many lies you tell to cover up other lies? How many times have you had to pretend something to make sure you get over what you need to do because you was in this self-inflicted false responsibility bondage? And so was your day good? Come on, answer that one. And then was your life consumed at any time by your own obsession with what somebody else was doing. You know, were you obsessed about what you're trying to get done for your selfish motive, and so you want to connect with somebody else so you can get your dependence thing on while using bondage, because it was for somebody else. It really wasn't for you. This is the reason why you couldn't get what you needed, because you was faking. Lord, help us all. And so then, if it was in this point that I just pointed out, how can you behave a better way? What can you do instead to keep you from being in this false responsibility mode that's caused you to be in this dependence bondage? Well, one thing you could do is you want to take a moment right now to reflect on this, what I'm about to tell you. Now, I want you to make sure you do this, because this is very important just for today. I want you to write a note to yourself about what you could do the next time that you are thinking to allow yourself to take on a responsibility and be held hostage for somebody else's stuff or somebody else's behavior. What can I do to not make this part of my life, make this part of my day? What can I do, God? Talk to God and ask him that when you're writing that note. What can I do to not fake? What can I do to not take on the responsibility and be stuck in this dependence bondage? Ask the Lord that. What can you do the next time you see this coming on when you go to work in the morning, or you're getting around your cliques or your friends? What can you do so you won't have this dependence bondage hanging on you, and these vows, the things that you're promising to do, you know you have no intentions of doing, because you want to make sure that they think that you're with them and that you love them? That's a sad thing. That's a sad place to be in. And so being obsessed, you need to understand this, being obsessed or being dependent of being irresponsible to the point that you've taken on a responsibility, you know, that you're obsessed with other people's stuff, trying to get connected with other people's things that God ain't told you to do, you will never, ever, you hear me, come to the success in your own life, because you're too busy trying to make sure that you take on a responsibility, that's my bell, that is not of God and not sent from God. Most of the time, the reason why we're in this dependence bondage is because, again, like I said, it's the vows, it's the motives, it's the timeline that you want something done, or you feel like you're going to be behind, or you feel like you're not going to look super spiritual or look like you've got something going on. So, you know, ministry or relationship. So you rather be in this false responsibility or this false soul tie or this codependence, really what it is, bondage. I don't understand that. Repeat this after me, because I'm going to get off here. And so, Father, I thank you that they're hearing by the Spirit that you've given me the time to take out of my day to do this, that they can recognize that these vows that they've made that you're not pleased with, these things that they've done and said that you're not pleased with, that they'll begin to meditate on these and write these notes to themselves to be reminded that you don't want them to have these vows that they didn't keep or have this dependence bondage type of mentality that they're in. And so repeat this after me. I will pray. Yes, you will. I will pray to my God, my Father, Jesus Christ, to remember. Come on, say it. I will pray to my God and my Lord, Jesus Christ, to remember that every life, every person I come in contact with, is divinely unfolding, and it doesn't need my attempt to control it, to have false responsibility in it. Neither do I need to pretend that this is what I need to be able to get to where God is taking me for the purpose in my life. And so today I speak that to you, that you will have this journey of the bondage breaker even now, as I speak the blood and the cross of Calvary even now over your life to break the dependence bondage off of your life, and that even now you will no longer be consumed with everybody else's stuff, and that you will begin to look unto the Father, your King, Jesus Christ, who is the author and the finisher of your life and is the only one that can fulfill your needs and come timely in your life to bring forth what he has put inside of you for kingdom building. God bless you. I pray this has helped you. And remember, as I always say, it's up to you. God bless you. Please pass it on.